with us on Indian Open on Bloomberg Quint. Real estate is a relatively new business vertical when compared to the Godrej Group's 121-year-old history. But it's grown fast over the last years to spread its reach across the country in both the commercial and the residential space. Joining us now to talk in the studios to talk about what could happen to the Godrej properties maybe 5 years out is the man leading the team at Godrej Properties, Firoz Shah Godrej. Firoz Shah, so good having you. Thanks so much for taking the time out.
Thanks. It's great to be with you.
Thank you. We all know that the landscape has changed quite meaningfully in real estate since in the last 10 years of its listed history in India. But you have to say on the regulatory front as well, and in the way the demand-supply situation is emerging, the last 1.5 years has been unlike almost anything that we've seen in the recent past.
Yeah, you know, it's always been an exciting sector. I think the kind of development that's happened in the sector really in the last 10 years has been remarkable. I think the quality of projects now being delivered, the quality of some of the leading developers, I think has undergone a big change. And as you say, the last year and a half has been particularly eventful with the introduction of RERA, with the changes like the GST. Here in Mumbai, we have the new development plan now coming out. So I think certainly it's a sector that is one that's very dynamic, always changing. And there's a huge opportunity at the moment, I think, for developers within the sector to make the most and set themselves up for growth in what has been a weak market the last couple of years.
Yeah, certainly so. So, you know, let's discuss all of those points one by one. If I look at the here and now, and then we move on to what will happen far out, your Q4 pre-sales, if there are any indication, you are in for a very strong FY19, FY20. Q4 had some massive amount of pre-sales done, and that is only indicative of what would happen, right? Because your project completions will continue on time as you always done. So FY19, FY20 are very strong?
Yes, we also now have interest starting this quarter in all likelihood a new accounting methodology which moves to a project completion accounting. So it might be a slight delay before the pre-sales from last financial year actually hit the P&L. But yes, I think we expect a very strong year ahead as well. I think the plans we have in terms of new launches for the current financial year are quite exciting. Last year was actually our best ever year from a pre-sales perspective. We sold about 5,000 crore worth of space, a growth of 150% year on year. And I think the other big success last year was business development, where we actually added more than 20 million square feet of new projects into our portfolio. And we hope to launch a lot of those this year. So I think that will really create the visibility and continued momentum on the sales front. And as you rightly said, in this business, given the accounting really follows the pre-sales, it is a matter of time before those get recognized in the P&L.
So actually, can you dwell on that a bit? The new accounting that you mentioned as well, a few days ago, we were talking to DLF and they said that they do not want to make any launches now for the next two or three years, except probably one, because the new accounting norms will mean that all of their existing projects, once they get completed, will only start showing up. So therefore, they are not looking at making some new launches. What changes will this new accounting norm bring to you? The reason I also asked this to you, in May, you were at an investor conference wherein you guys said that you were waiting for some clarity. It's been a month now. Has some clarity emerged on what impact would these new norms have on, say, for a company like you or for the sector at large?
You know, it's still not something that's completely final, and I think the industry has been representing against it. So I think
against these
new standards. But my sense is it's very, very likely now that, I mean, they are already in force. It's very unlikely that there will be any delay from this quarter in its implementation. Honestly, we don't see any real impact on the business itself. The underlying cash flows of the business, which is what we're running the business based on, don't change as a result of this. What changes is the revenue recognition and the timing of that revenue recognition from an accounting perspective. And I think we'll have to communicate with investors about what these changes mean. Essentially, it'll mean that the recognition in your accounts will be delayed anywhere from 12 to 24 months. We don't think this calls in any way for a shift or change in strategy. In fact, there are some projects that you have already recognized in the accounts that will now get re-recognized as they complete. So even the near term isn't very adversely affected, even from an accounting perspective. But I think the underlying point is that, you know, the real focus for us is to maximize the net present value of our operating cash flows. And that is not at all affected by this change.
Yeah, so for the longest time, I remember, Firoz Shah, I mean, since the time the sector launched, right, or got listed, let me put it that way, the norms of how to value these companies has changed dramatically. Earlier, it used to be the NAV of the land bank that you have. Now, that concept has more or less gone away, and we moved to this you know, project completion method or whatever, as it's getting completed, you start recognizing revenues and maybe value companies, real estate companies, the way other companies were valued as well. Do you see the way people or the market could value real estate companies changing as a result of these norms, or not quite?
You know, I think for many of the lesser known developers, the smaller developers, probably mostly in the unlisted set, this could create some challenges from their access to capital from banks, because what it will do is in the immediate term reduce their net worth, as projects that have reached revenue recognition but are not complete will have to be adjusted through the reserve. So it could create some dislocation on that side. But I think for the listed players for whom the markets better understand the operations, I don't expect any major change. And there has been this dilemma, as you pointed out, on how best to value real estate companies, whether to look at more an NAV-based valuation or price-earnings-based valuation. And you know, neither of them, frankly, are perfect. This will, I think, create an even bigger disconnect between the reported P&L numbers and the actual operational numbers. So I think investors are going to have a harder time figuring out exactly what all of this means. It doesn't affect from a developer's perspective, as I said, that much, but it's the fact that now your operational sales are really only going to be recognized in your accounts probably 3 years from now will create some amount of uncertainty, I think, for investors.
Yeah, let's wait and watch what happens. Since you spoken about that, I mean, you don't seem to be having any trouble for growth capital, right? The recent fundraise as well probably sets you up for the next leg of growth. Are you satisfied with the kind of funding, if I can use that term, that you have available for the next leg of your growth?
Yes, absolutely. I think, you know, one of the key advantages we have is, as a group and as a business, attractive access to capital, both in terms of equity and, as you rightly pointed out, for the first time in 5 years, we did raise some equity at the entity level this quarter, when we've just recently received those funds. So that's about 1,000 crore of equity capital that we now have at our disposal. One of the other advantages we have is access to, well-priced borrowing. Our average borrowing cost today is 7.8%. We actually do think that given the kind of opportunities present in the real estate sector, given the company's current scale, that the big focus area for us for the next few years has to be growth. And I think the combination of the 1,000 crore of equity capital we just raised, plus the debt that we can use on top of that, and as a result of that increase the amount of debt we have, does give us a significant amount of capital to invest in new projects. And that is one of the primary focus areas for the company right now. And actually, the fact that markets itself are quite weak makes this the opportune time for those kind of deployments.
So what's the way ahead, Pirosha, the next 2 years? And two, three ways in which I would want to ask this question. The first is, you've kind of pioneered this model of, in a manner of speaking, enter into a JV with land bank owners or developers who may not have either the brand value or the capital to complete projects. So you come in, I arguably don't make any fresh investments, but your brand name and your completion strategies result in you getting 40, 50, 60% share, as the case may be. There are certain other players well-known names who've gone out and purchased land bank. You, I believe, haven't quite done that in the last 2, 3 years. Will that change now? In the next 2 years, would you move slightly away from this joint development model which you've almost championed, to start buying or aggregating land bank in a meaningful way?
No, I think we're actually very happy with how well this partnership model has worked for us. And I think the logic has always been that real estate development is a very capital intensive business. It is a very cyclical business. So to be able to grow rapidly and do it in a risk mitigated manner, we think this is a very important part of that strategy. And essentially what we're trying to do by this is both maintain a better risk profile than we could by buying land, and also grow much faster, because capital, if we were buying land, would very quickly become a constraint on growth. Now, the other thing that we think the joint venture model offers is much higher returns on capital. And again, it has been typically a sector that has delivered very poor ROEs and ROCs. And one of the ideas of using this model is to break down that historical trend that we've seen. Now, it's not that we will never buy land or can never buy land. It's not a philosophical question. It's a simple matter of what will maximize our returns and what will generate the best risk-adjusted returns. We believe in almost every case the joint joint venture model will do that better than an outright purchase of land will be. But there are instances where that doesn't necessarily hold true. So for example, land where you can pay for the land over time as you're generating project cash flows is one such example. Another is projects which already have some of the regulatory approvals in place, and therefore you can turn around the project much faster, and therefore the risk on the project is much lower. So I think we're perfectly open to looking at such opportunities, but with the understanding that I think the joint venture model has gotten us to where we are today, and we think it's a valuable part of sort of the toolkit of future growth as well.
Interesting. So let's now talk about what scale, etc., can you reach from where you are right now, unless I'm very wrong. Two numbers, firstly, you, I believe, achieved what? Sales of about 1 million square feet in each quarter in the last fiscal?
Yeah, we did about 6.5 million square feet in the year, so about a little over 1.5 million.
Almost each quarter.
Per quarter,
now,
yeah.
Now, where does this scale go up to? Because you mentioned about the kind of projects that you already signed up for and the developable area that you have at hand. What does FY19, FY20 show us?
Well, you know, we try to stay away from giving any kind of guidance in this sector, because frankly, knowing what's going to happen tomorrow isn't very easy. So trying to project, you know, what's going to happen 1 or 2 years ahead, we feel it's just better to stay away from that. But look, I think our sense is that while we're happy with the relative scale we've achieved in the industry for the last few years now, at least amongst the listed players, we've been the leading player by value of real estate sold. But we fully understand that we're just scratching the surface of the kind of growth opportunity available in this sector. Despite our relative position being quite strong, if you look at it, our absolute market share we estimate is only about 1% of the sector. Mm. And our sense is, you know, we prefer to look at it as more of a 10-year journey. And over that 10 years, we often say that we think there's every chance that India is going to be the best performing major country in the world, that within India, the real estate sector is going to be the best performing major sector, and we have every opportunity to be one of the best performing companies within that sector. Now, if we look at, you know, international benchmarks, countries like China have real estate developers that are selling 300 million square feet of real estate per year. And again, I mentioned that we in our best year last year did 6.5. So I think the headroom for growth is likely to be very significant and likely to be something that really persists over the next 1 or 2 decades. And I think what our job now is to make sure we're capturing as much of the current share as we can, but also setting up a platform that's able to really scale into something much more meaningful over the next decade.
So again, not getting into numbers, but looking at one, the regulatory environment that exists in India vis-a-vis other countries, and the execution bandwidth that any single player would have, you reckon that not really going up to 300 million, but even 1/4 of that by a single company like that is possible over the next 5 years, 10 years? Are you setting yourself for that?
I certainly hope so, and you know, I certainly think so. It will obviously depend on how the overall economy does, how the sector plays out. But certainly our sense is that India is going to be a fast-growing country, that at this stage of a country's economic growth, real estate is an industry that tends to perform disproportionately, because as disposable incomes rise, one of the first things people want is homes. Factors like urbanization, demographics, where you have increasing amounts of families living in nuclear family units, all of these point to a very rapid growth in the sector. And certainly there is no argument that I see that the sector will remain as fragmented as it is today. Already there is rapid consolidation happening. The advantage the stronger players have in terms of ability to access customers with their brands, ability to attract finance at much more reasonable cost, are all very, very significant advantages, and to my mind are not going to go anywhere over the next 10 years. So you will see a fast-growing industry, and within that you will see the better performing players consolidating the market. And certainly I think the largest five developers in India will all be, you know, 5 or 10x their size today, 10 years from now. Now, obviously, it's our job to make sure that we're one-off and leading those developers, but it's very hard for us to see any argument that the sector itself is not going to do well over the next 10 years, or that within the sector, the best performing developers aren't going to disproportionately gain from that growth in the sector. Those we are treating as almost givens.
Wow. Okay, so in which case, does this whole scale-up happen at much better cash flows, because I think your cash flows improved quite a bit in FY18, if I'm not wrong, northwards of 1,000 crores compared to a negative cash flow in the year before. Does this spate of positive cash flows continue, one? And two, in the earlier answers, you mentioned about, you know, breaking up this whole notion of real estate companies not having positive return or better return ratios. Would you believe that 5 years out, 8 years out, whatever the number may be, the return on equity, return on capital would be, as a ratio, would be substantially higher than where it is right now for Godrej Properties?
I think yes on both those questions. I think, you know, certainly operating cash flows need to be very tightly managed in this sector. As soon as your operating cash flows go out of whack, it is a sector where, you know, things can turn negative quite quickly. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean every quarter and every year operating cash flows, because it is, you know, it is a lumpy industry by its nature. But certainly, I think one needs to be throwing up operating cash to be able to invest in the next round of projects for one's growth. So I think that is very important. I think on the point whether returns on equity and capital will increase over the next decade, certainly I think they will. One, because I think there's a lot of learning that's already happened for developers and investors on the dangers of having return multiples where they are today. For Godrej Properties, for example, the two key financial goals we've set ourselves over the next 4 or 5 years is, one, to be amongst the top couple of players in each of the cities that we're present in terms of value of real estate sold. And secondly, to more than double ROEs that have been visible in the sector to about 20%. So I think those are the two key goals.
Where are you currently on that?
Where we've been in the range of 10 to 12% the last 2 or 3 years.
You hope to be reached about a 20% mark in maybe 5 odd years
or
thereabouts?
Right. That's right.
Wow. Okay. A couple of other questions. You know, a lot of people that we speak to of late now talk about how real estate as an investment play might not be as fruitful as it has been in the past. When you're talking about growth in numbers, are you talking about a growth in numbers purely from volumes, or do you believe prices by and large in the pockets that you are the strongest in, which would be Bombay, NCR, maybe Pune and Bangalore, would also move up?
Well, I think the fundamental underpinning of the growth must be volumes. And I think that's where a lot of our focus will be, on making sure we have the right number of projects, that we're present in the right number of micro markets to be able to keep growing from a volumes perspective. That said, you know, it is a very cyclical industry. It always has been. And it's one where I've always, you know, noticed at different points in the cycle, public mood tends to assume that what is currently the reality will persist forever. So we've been in a bit of a downturn. So now people think that, you know, real estate's a terrible investment and won't see much capital appreciation. My view is that in the next 12 months or so, we will start seeing a strong upturn in the sector. Mm-hmm. All the economic underlying indicators are quite positive. GDP has been growing well. Interest rates have been at the historical lows. Affordability has been the best it's been in the country for about 15 years. So all of that points to a revival in the sector. And once that revival starts, you know, the sector tends to move very quickly. So we saw it in the recent financial crisis, where things came to a complete standstill in 2008 and most of 2009. But by 2010, the sector was again booming. So my expectation is that once you see that volume starting to come back, you will actually also see prices move. And there'll probably be at least 1 year in the next five, I'll stick my neck out and predict, where you'll see a pretty sharp pop in prices in a short period.
But back then, the prices had moved down as well very, very sharply. This lull hasn't seen a dramatic price correction, right? Maybe to the tune of 20-25%, at least in the Mumbai markets?
Well, you know, I think there's not even been a 20-25% in Mumbai.
On the table, you go in with the
sure. Chair. I think that, you know, I'd say probably more like 0-10% is somewhere like Mumbai. In somewhere like NCR, you've probably seen more that 30% kind of price correction, which is quite significant. That's not a small amount. Also, you have to keep in mind that if you're talking about a 4 or 5 year period, even flat prices in effect is a, you know, time-led reduction, because you've had inflation over that period. You've had people's incomes rising by, you know, 7-8% a year over that period. So the affordability of a product that is priced the same today as it was 5 years ago is dramatically different for a customer, because their income has probably gone up 30% over that time. Interest rates are, you know, 300 basis points lower. So the actual amount of their income they need to spend on that property is very different than it was.
So, okay, last question really. let's say in the next 5 years, you stuck your neck out and said that there is an outside chance that prices 1 year will show a bit of a pop, what segment to your mind will do well? You present across both, maybe predominantly residential, but you present across both. You think commercial does better or residential does better here on?
Well, you know, I think for us, the big bet is on residential. We certainly think the commercial market is interesting and are looking at different ways of playing that. But from a total scale of industry and total scale of opportunity, there's no doubt that the residential segment to us is the bigger one. And I also think that actually it's the right time to be investing in residential, because if you look at it, the commercial cycle...
As a developer, you mean?
As a developer and even as a home buyer.
Okay.
Because if you look at it, the commercial segment really never recovered from the financial crisis until about 2016 or so, and then has had a very good last couple of years, and you know has been attracting a lot of investment. But I think it's already, you know, prices have recovered in commercial real estate, cap rates are actually very low. So I think in all likelihood, it's not the low point in the commercial real estate cycle. I think there's many more years of positivity in that space, but it's certainly not the low point. Whereas on the residential side, you know, the sector has actually now been going through a 5-year downturn. It is, I think, primed to see things improving. As I mentioned, the affordability being where it is the main trigger,
true,
I believe, to that to that next leg of the cycle. And also the residential sector is just a much bigger sector than commercial real estate. So certainly it's the area where we're most focused on.
Okay. Pirosha, Maman, thanks so much for joining us today and giving us a lowdown on, well, the sector at large and what Godrej Properties could do as well. Some fairly encouraging words for investors too. So thanks so much for doing that today.
Great to be with you. Thanks.
Likewise. And well, with that, it's a wrap on this leg of Indian Open. Thanks so much for watching. The market's absolutely flat. Up next is the FNO Show. Stay tuned to Bloomberg Quinn Live.